Hello.
Hello, how are you?
I'm all right, Sean.
Yes, good to meet you.
Yeah, nice to finally meet face to face.
Yes.
What's the score with your username on Instagram?
What's Ebhead? What's the story with it? So there's a band from Essex actually called Nitzer Ebb, sort of an electronic, almost industrial band. And one of their albums was called Ebhead, and I liked it a lot, and therefore
The rest is history.
I've attached all of my in fact I've even got a, well, I don't know how well it'll show up, but I've even got a tattoo of the symbols from one of their albums on my arm. So
I do feel like I've heard of them before.
I was diagnosed in May of this year. So I turned 50 in April, and a couple of weeks, few weeks before my 50th birthday, I felt something unusual on my right pec, and asked my wife, this feels unusual, doesn't it? And she agreed. Probably more information than you need, but I had gynecomastia growing up as well. So slightly larger, slightly more breast tissue than most men have. A lot of men actually get it taken care of. Mine was sort of at the point where I just looked a little overweight versus like I had, full breasts, so I kind of left it. I don't know if I regret that decision now, because I met a lot of men actually remove, have a basically a breast reduction early on. But my doctor assures me that would not have precluded me from getting the cancer anyway. But because of that, I always had like small tender areas around my nipples, and I don't know if this is too much information than you, more than you need, but I figure if anybody is going to understand what I'm talking about and going through, then it would be you. But it was different than that. So it was different because it was immovable. It was clearly stationary and attached to tissue, and it was larger. So it was something that I knew warranted attention. So I went in for my physical, pointed it out, and thankfully the my primary care doctor, the facility that he is based in, had a radiology department right in the same building. He sent me down right away and had a ultrasound, and I actually did a mammography, and assumed what they were seeing was breast cancer, but told me I needed to get a biopsy. So,
Same day was that, the biopsy.
same day as my physical, yes.
Because one of the weird things that I was told when I had the mammogram was they can only say it is cancer. They can't say it's not cancer, apparently. And I was like, wow, okay, is that good or bad? Because I couldn't work it out. It was a bit too confusing for me, but yeah, so they can definitely say it is, but they can't rule it out, kind of thing. So yeah, obviously the biopsy, yeah, it's not nice, is it?
No, it wasn't. And they offered, they had the ability, not directly in that facility, but through their network, to do that. But I live in New York, and one of the premier cancer facilities in the United States, one of the top in the world, Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, is in New York. So I actually, rather than go through a smaller medical network, I decided to see if I could somehow be seen by a doctor there, have the biopsy done there, and figure out what my plan of action would be. Well, and I was able to get in relatively quickly, a couple of weeks, which, you know, were nerve-wracking weeks waiting for the biopsy. I was able to get in, and then very quickly was connected with once they confirmed that it was in fact breast cancer. I was able to get in pretty quickly with a surgeon.
That's good.
I think within days
Yeah.
of how the results of the biopsy.
So that when you initially went in and you had all the tests done, did they hint that it was cancer, or did they tell you it was cancer, or did they kind of not say anything?
When I was having the biopsy done,
Yeah, when you initially went in.
the radiology team that did the biopsy, they were going off of the scans from the other facility. So they hinted that it probably was. They did not want to actually say that it was. They, you know, that the testing would reveal the reality of it, but they did hint that it was likely that it would be cancer.
Yeah. So on that day, they said the C word basically on that day, on the day of the mammogram and the biopsy.
They didn't give me the determination, but they did say that you know, from what they were seeing, that they knew that they were going to be removing tests, removing tissue from the biopsy. And that it would confirm if it was cancer, but the way that the radiologist was speaking about it, she was pretty, she was definitely being diplomatic about it,
Yeah.
but she was speaking about it as though it was going to come back as cancer.
Right. Yeah, because I mean that's I went from I'll just turn up and get the tests, and then after the test sat down in front of the surgeon and he was like, "We think it's cancer." He literally didn't say anything else. He sat down, "We think it's cancer," straight away. But then I was taken away with the Macmillan nurse, who's your like the more softly, softly kind of support system that you have in the UK. And then she was like, "You've not been told you've got cancer." And I was like, "Wow, this is weird." Because then you're in this like limbo, aren't you, where you've been told it might be, but you've not it's not been confirmed. So it's a weird time. I mean, for you, it's so fresh. Are you all right talking about it?
I am.
Were you upset at the time?
You know what? It's interesting. So my mother was diagnosed with breast cancer very early, probably in her around 38 or 39. And she survived through surgery and a mastectomy and radiation and chemo. And she survived for many years with no recurrence. So in a weird way, between seeing what my mother had gone through relatively early in life, and also, although it's unrelated, just the feelings around the condition that I mentioned, the gynecomastia, and having some breast tissue, I figured it was a matter of time.
Really?
And
Wow.
you know, I'm sure I could see a psychiatrist about that and figure out if that was the right headspace to be in. But you know, I really did feel like at some point in my life, this would be something that I would probably need have to face. There's also a very, very strong occurrence of cancer on my maternal side. So all of her siblings, every single one of her siblings, had cancer. Three of them died from cancer. So, and my maternal grandmother died from cancer. So, you know, I just assumed that cancer was going to be in my future at some point anyway.
I mean, that I think the perspective I probably, the spin I would put on it would be that you were more conscious of changes in your body, which
Yes.
probably helped you by almost thinking it was going to happen.
Right. I
Possibly.
think it did. I think you're right, because anytime I would feel something unusual, specifically on the chest, although, I think, I probably would have noticed elsewhere, but yeah, I think I was probably more prone to being aware of changes and not blowing it off. Somebody said to me, how did you know that, you didn't just, hit yourself in a corner of a dresser and chest of drawers, and it was just swollen tissue. And I said, it just this it that's not what it felt like. It
No.
felt very different. And yeah.
Yeah, I get it. I get it, 'cause that's what I had. So how big was the tumor when you felt it?
Right. So they the radiology thought it was 9 millimeters,
Okay. That's
but it actually, when they removed it, was actually closer to 19 millimeters, so pretty significant difference.
So what was the time difference between those two measurements? Do you know?
Not that long, probably less than 2 weeks.
Wow.
Yeah, so I don't think it actually grew that much in that time frame. I think they just did a poor job of estimating the height,
Right, okay.
or the size, the
Yeah.
mass.
I mean, obviously, like with a really aggressive cancer, I get the impression it can grow really, really quickly. So,
Absolutely. My surgeon thought, he wasn't sure, but he thought that there was a likelihood that I had probably had the tumor for a significant amount of time, for probably a year or more.
yeah.
So I don't
Well,
think it was, but yeah, that's his guess.
I mean, you were never gonna feel it when it was initially grown,
Sure.
because it was gonna be too
Sure.
small. So yeah, I get it. I get it. So okay, so the question that I, whenever I'm questioned, interviewed, do a newspaper interview or something like that, is everyone always says, "How was it as a man entering a world which is predominantly kind of like filled with women?" And I'm gonna ask you that question. What was it like for you as a man,
Yeah.
how did it feel?
I think it made for it's a it's interesting. The other day I was interviewed actually for a newspaper, and the question that was asked was, did you feel shame? And I thought that the premise of the question, I think, presupposes that I should feel shame.
Yeah.
And I don't think I felt shame, but it made it difficult to speak about, just because although most people that I spoke with said, oh, of course, I've heard that men can get it. I mean, most people don't know a man who has been diagnosed with breast cancer. But I think, whether it was shame or whether it was, I'm trying to think of a better word for what I dealt with, because I think that certainly when I initially would tell people about it, unless I was very close with them, I would say that I was diagnosed with cancer. I
Yeah.
wouldn't specify. And, if they would ask more, I think if for me, telling people that I was diagnosed with cancer, if you tell people you're diagnosed with breast cancer, that there's almost a quizzical look that people get. And you know, I don't, there's nothing quizzical about it. I mean, cancer is cancer. And you know, so I felt more comfortable telling people that I was diagnosed with cancer. If they asked about it, you know, how did you know? How did you find out? Well, I felt something on my pec, you know. So I was kind of talking around it.
Yeah, but it sounds almost like the person asking the question on that occasion was forcing you in a direction, which is really unnecessary because you felt how you felt regardless of
I
what.
felt, yeah. I mean, I'm not ashamed that I had cancer. I mean, you know, cancer happens to people all the time, and you know, it just happens. You know,
Yeah.
there's
I think the thing for me, whenever I've gone down the I had cancer route,
yes.
and then you look at their face, you can see they're just assuming the stereotypical male
Yes.
cancers. They just assume that that's what it's going to be. So I enjoy it because I say cancer and then I tell them, or I say, try and guess which one. Or I'll say, you'll never guess. And then I say, I've given you a massive clue there. You might be able to guess it by saying you won't be able to guess it.
Yes.
And I have a little play. I play with people.
Right. When were you diagnosed again?
So I was diagnosed. It was July 2016.
Okay.
So I hit my excuse me, 5 year anniversary this year, and then I got discharged, dropped off the
Right.
tamoxifen.
Yes.
And then obviously a month later I had my little scare, which is kind of still ongoing, which I think is going to be okay in the long term. But
But still nothing, no.
so the scan results are in, the doctor's got the scan results, and I'm now waiting to have a telephone consultation with the doctor, but the email said it was reassuring. So,
Okay.
and there seems to be no urgency to talk to me about it, so I'm assuming it's okay.
Okay, good.
I'll be pissed off if it's something serious.
Course. Of
But
course.
yeah, I mean, obviously 5 years later, I was like, well, I negotiated those 5 years quite well, and it seemed to be uneventful almost.
Right.
And
Right.
then I started saying to people, oh, I think I looked at some stats, and it was saying that, most men don't make it to 5 years. The majority of men
Right.
are dead by then, which is pretty
Because
frightening.
they often find it so late, right?
Yes, mainly because of that, yeah. So
And you felt yours as well?
it sounds like a very similar to kind of like timeline. So my daughter elbowed me,
Right, I remember reading this, yes.
and I just like, what? It was just, I don't know whether it just drew my attention to it, and then later that day, I was like, no, there's definitely something there. There's something there, and exactly how you described it, it was more solid. It wasn't, there wasn't, I don't think there was a lot of give in it. It was pretty solid.
Right.
So I was like, look, right, don't dwell on it. Went to bed, and then literally the next day, went to the doctor. My story is, I rang the doctors, found it on the Sunday night. Rang the doctors on 8:30 on the Monday morning, and then 17 minutes past 9, I was in front of a doctor getting it looked at.
Oh, wow.
But she was
Wow.
like, but she literally was scratching her head, because obviously a lot of doctors have never ever seen it in a man,
Sure.
and
Yeah.
that in itself is really, really dangerous. So I mean, I was
Yes.
going to, I'm trying to think of an example. I think I had some bloods taken. And I said, oh, obviously I've had lymph nodes removed. I said, you can't go in that arm. And then I would tell the nurse it was breast cancer. And then I'm like, do you want to see my mastectomy scar? Do you want to, just so if I can help give you a little bit of
Right.
knowledge. Obviously, there's no nipple there for them to look at, or no
Right.
tumor. But because they were like, I've never
Yeah.
seen a man with a mastectomy
Right.
scar. So yeah,
Right.
we are in a very, very small,
Yes.
tiny minority.
Yes.
And I don't know, see, again, I think this, I mean, because it's so early for you, I think, I don't know how you'll feel about it, but everyone I speak to is like, oh, you're on a mission to raise awareness for men's breast cancer, which of course I am, but I don't think it's about that. Because we are such a tiny, tiny group. I mean, don't get me wrong, if I could help save a man's life, amazing. But I'm like, know you're normal and like persevere if you find something different. Get to the doctors, regardless of male, female, young, old. That's my mission. But you did the right thing. I mean, obviously, I think you were super aware, and I think some men aren't as quick to be to react to changes in their body. They might sit back. 'Cause I even spoke to a guy who he was 69, who one of the charities like linked me up with, so I could talk to somebody, and he said he found a lump, and he went, meh. Don't like the look of that. I'll just kind of ignore it. And he said he could see it grow. And then his wife was like, "What is that sticking out of your chest?" And it was literally, it was protruding out of his chest. And of course, he had chemo and radiotherapy, and he went through a terrible time. So the next question is, did you have just surgery? Is that either so we're the same? Yeah. Now, does it is that how's that been for you? Because I know that limited the support groups I could get involved with in the UK.
So, well, I'm not sure precisely the differences on how that works here, but they were actually able to do something called oncotyping against my cancer cells. So they actually sent out after the surgery, after they did the pathology, they determined it was bigger than they realized, and that it was actually so I actually had to have two surgeries because the tumor was probably about 3 or 4 centimeters from my nipple, which is unusual because men, it's almost always attached to the nipple. And so because I had the gynecomastia, they initially said, we might actually be able to do a lumpectomy, possibly we can try that. We're not sure that it would succeed, but because I had the gynecomastia, because I had never done any sort of breast reduction, I actually opted for bilateral mastectomy. So I had them both removed. Partially for peace of mind, and partially because it was going to be covered by the insurance for the procedure anyway. So I opted to do that. And where was I going? What were we something about the
One,
doctor.
yeah, so like did not having radiotherapy and chemo,
Oh,
did
yes,
that
right.
put you in a bit of an odd another minority group?
Well, it's interesting. So that was what I was getting at, though. So I'm sorry. So that they did the pathology and they realized that although it wasn't directly connected to the nipple, there was sort of a, it was a, it was not a perfectly round shape. And part of it was attached to my nipple. There was some, so I actually had to go in for a second surgery. They tried to originally save the nipple. They had to go then back in and take the nipple. So did it put me in an unusual category? So the oncotyping came back. They were actually able to pair my cells with other people who have had, other men who have had radiation or chemo, and it showed no appreciable difference. In fact, my although it was larger than they realized at 19 centimeters, millimeters, centimeters would be very large. They they were able to determine that there would be no significant difference in expectancy or recurrence from chemo or radiation. So the tamoxifen was the only follow-up treatment that I would need, right, based on what they had, so, which I was very relieved to hear.
So
your question about, you know, did it put me, I actually felt very fortunate to not need chemo and radiation. I am sure that there would be a whole other network of people that I could relate to if I was currently going through either or both of those treatments. But I'm actually, I feel very fortunate that I caught it when I did, that they were able to do this pretty unusual oncotyping testing against the cancer cells that, you know, and that I can be treated primarily or exclusively at this point, I guess, really by medication, yeah, which I think.
Did they take out lymph nodes? Obviously, they must have taken.
They did a sentinel lymph node test. So actually, while I was in the operating room, they removed probably about 5 lymph nodes from my right side and tested them right there to see if there was any indication of spread to the lymph nodes, and there wasn't. So they actually didn't need to remove all of the lymph nodes from that side. So there were some removed, but not, but they didn't remove them all, which again, I felt very fortunate to have been able to have that done.
Yeah. See, I had to wait a further 2 weeks to get my lymph node results.
Okay. So they did that first and then went in for the surgery after they tested the lymph nodes?
No. So I had the mastectomy and lymph nodes removed on the same day. Woke up, went home. 2 weeks later, went back in for the lymph node results to see if I need chemo or radiotherapy, which I didn't, luckily. So does that mean are you estrogen receptor positive then? To be on tamoxifen, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you feel, how do you feel now you're on tamoxifen?
It's probably about 2 months now that I've been on it. So about 8 weeks. So really not that long, but long enough to know that I'm tired a lot. I think that's really been my primary side effect of the tamoxifen. And my wife probably would say that I have brain fog quite a lot, but I think that she would have said that before I was diagnosed with the cancer anyway. So so who knows what the relationship is there to the medication. I've noticed some thinning of hair.
Oh, right. So apparently it should be the opposite.
Really?
Apparently, so that my GP said he'd never given it to a man before. He normally says, you're going to get hair growth. You're going to get a deepening of the voice. This is what he's normally saying to older women normally.
Right.
And I was like, more hair? Cool. I mean, I've got enough. And then deepening of voice. Yeah, that's fine. So, but the tiredness for me was just was always a bit of an issue, and the whole way through was.
Sure.
Yeah. So, sure. So how did it, what is it you actually work as?
Yeah. So I started a business during, actually just a year ago this month. And I am working, as a career coach.
All right,
cool. So helping people who are currently working in the corporate world to look at alternative options outside of working in a corporate job. So whether that's primarily what I help them learn about is business ownership, So really working to educate them on working with them to develop a goals-based coaching program, around to determine if business ownership is the way to achieve their goals.
Cool. It's going
So it's
well.
been,
Going well.
yeah, it's been going well. It's been very busy, sort of a strange time for me to start a business, but also given the shifts in attitudes of people in the workplace and wanting, the reevaluation of priorities, I think that's happened during the pandemic. I think has been it's been an interesting time to do this.
So how did the, obviously having surgery and going to the hospital and doing all those kind of things and looking after yourself post-surgery, was your work impacted by that?
Pretty significantly, actually. I had just started the business in October. I was diagnosed in May or early May. By the second, third week of May, I had the surgery, and my business went on pause for at least 4 weeks, but realistically, I wasn't back up and running until mid-August, I would say, is when I sort of really started to get back into things. So it was tough because it was tough because I felt like I had just really hit in a groove before everything was kind of thrown off. I feel like I'm back on track now, but it did. It took a while. Even, so I was back up and running in August, but realistically, it wasn't until late September that I think I sort of fully got my groove back. And there's still a lot of clients that I was dealing with initially before my diagnosis who I haven't sort of realigned with. So at some point my business will be fully 100% back up to normal.
Yeah, that's cool. We did it. I was speaking to somebody yesterday about obviously health insurance in the US and obviously how it's different from the UK. There was an eye roll then. I saw an eye roll.
Yes,
Was it
yes.
was that hard? I mean, obviously working for yourself. Did you?
Thankfully, my wife, through her employer, we have really great health insurance. In fact, I just paid my I just received the bills for my biopsy and then also for the mastectomy surgery. There's still some outstanding things that I guess my insurance company is questioning or the hospital is questioning. So it's probably not the final number, but my co-payment, the what I owed for the surgery, was only $50,
Really?
which was wonderful. Yeah.
Wow.
For the why am I spacing? For the biopsy, it was a little over $500 that I owed. So,
Right, okay.
my guess is that at some point, the bills will start to catch up with me. But at least for now, it seems like that was it. I will have some sort of reconstruction. I'm not really sure what that's going to be. At some point, that was, sort of my care was cord my surgery was coordinated with a plastic surgeon as well. He didn't actually conduct the surgery, but he was in the room and sort of advising like
Yeah, that's
what
good.
the incision would be the best and all of that. So
Yeah. I mean,
we'll
yeah,
see.
so I mean I spoke to another guy and he was looking at reconstruction with like an implant or something.
Right.
Because obviously
I
you
don't think
got.
I'm, yeah, I don't think that I'll need that. But we'll see.
Yeah. So how do you feel when you look at your scar now in the mirror each morning? How do you feel? Is it still?
Much better now. Initially, I wasn't even looking at myself in the mirror.
Right.
I couldn't. It was very difficult. You know, I was intentionally sort of angling the mirror, angling myself to the mirror that I couldn't see it.
Yeah.
But now I'm much more comfortable with it.
Yeah. I think I had a moment when I went back to the hospital to get the dressings taken off, and I thought, am I gonna like faint? Am I gonna collapse? Am I gonna have a panic attack? But then I was like, I mean, my surgeon did a really great job, so my scar is tiny.
Tiny. Oh, good.
However, they went right into my armpit. They ripped it all out. They had a good rummage round, but like the scar
Oh.
is, I mean, you can see on my Instagram, the scar's absolutely tiny. It almost, I'm sure some people look at that and go, "Is that it?" It's like,
Yeah.
but obviously he just did it. He did a great job, basically.
Did a good job. Good. Good.
He, I think it was last summer, so I did a video consultation during lockdown last year, and he was like, "Do you want to start investigating 3D nipple tattoos?" And I was like, "Nah,
No.
I like it. I'll just say to people,
Yeah.
it's a shark bite."
That's
It's
great,
more of an
actually.
interesting story. And I still don't even feel. I'm not that self-conscious about it that I want to get a tattoo or anything like that. So, yeah. The interesting thing was, it didn't even click in my brain. I was thinking I might just get one of these tattoos where it kind of goes across your shoulder and down your arm. Because I've had lymph nodes removed, I don't think that can ever happen. Because obviously you could get the reaction, your lymph nodes, isn't it, where you.
Lymphedema or
Yeah,
yeah.
so I don't think, I'm thinking about it now, I'm not sure. Although, how does that work? Because a lot of people get
Yeah.
tattoos, don't they? They get post-surgery tattoos of like
Yeah.
birds and branches and all that kind of stuff.
Sure.
So I don't know.
Sure.
Maybe I can. I don't
Okay. Yeah.
know. That's for the future, I think. But
Yes. Yes.
the weird thing is, I'm kind of like all my new friends on Instagram that I've connected with in the cancer world, I'm now kind of getting little glimpses of, people that it's the cancer's come back. Obviously, people that haven't survived it and have died. So the very first modeling job that I did, there was the model I kind of did the work with on that first day. She passed away earlier this year, which was really sad. But the weird thing is, because I've not known that many people. I don't know. I think my perception of cancer is quite. I don't think I'm in the thick of it. I think I'm on the fringe. And obviously, I see glimpses of like, obviously, I think the biggest impact to me is the effect that it has on the people that survived. So it's the effects that the medication is having on them, or the amount of surgery they've got to go through, or and thankfully it's I've not seen that many people pass away from it. Are you connected with more cancer survivors online?
It's certain, yes, certainly since my diagnosis, absolutely. I feel like I'm part of a little bit of a network for sure. I joined, or yeah, I guess joined the Male Breast Cancer Coalition. I'm not sure if you're
Yeah, seen
familiar
that.
with them. Yes. So they've been a great resource, actually. They sent me before my surgery, sent me a whole packet of things like a recovery shirt that, you know, just Velcros down the middle, so you know you didn't have to, you know, stretch over your head or anything, which was wonderful. And you know, a bunch of you know, things that were just very helpful. But they've been a great resource too for a network of people. Coincidentally, somebody else who had also reached out to the Male Breast Cancer Coalition, a gentleman named Matt, who lives in, well, he lives in Idaho. He's from Arizona, and he had his surgery done in Arizona. He, the same week, 2 days before mine, was having the same exact double bilateral mastectomy procedure for the same diagnosis. So he and I have become, you know, friendly. He happened to be in New York a couple of months ago, so we met for a drink, and so he's a really nice guy, and yeah. And it's interesting because you know, we bounce ideas off each other, you know, like, oh, I've had some fluid buildup and I need to have be aspirated, you know, to remove some of the fluid. Is that something you're going through? Yes, that's something I'm, you know, so we're going through a lot of the same things at the same time.
Yeah.
Awesome. Surgery.
Yeah, that's amazing because obviously that's something that I didn't have. I couldn't find.
You couldn't find any
men that were gone through the exact same thing. I ended up speaking to more women that had surgery only. Yes. But of course, it is different between men and women.
It is. Yeah.
But yeah, no, it's amazing that you've connected. So have you spoke to any other men other than?
Yes.
Him?
Yeah. Yeah. So actually, through the hospital facility, the cancer facility that I had all of my care coordinated through, they connected me through with a network of people. Well, they've got a network of patients who either are, you know, recently diagnosed or have, you know, could be, you know, completely cancer free, but were treated there, who volunteer to connect with other patients and talk to them about their procedures and their process. And so I was able to connect with a couple of men who had been treated through Memorial Sloan Kettering as well,
right.
Which was good to hear.
Yeah.
I feel like the gentleman, Matt, from, well, lives in Idaho now, but because we were sort of a similar age, similar diagnosis, similar, you know, timeline, I've gotten the most from that. Yeah. But certainly speaking with, you know, for instance, speaking with you and speaking with, you know, some of the other gentlemen through the hospital's patient network, it was actually good to hear about people who were much further along and how their lives had been, what the process was like, you know, years in, and how their lives had been affected, or how their lives had been, you know, sort of minimally affected, which I think was reassuring.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. No. Let's not mention reoccurring.
No. That was a terrible slip of the tongue.
I didn't realize I created my Instagram account.
Yeah.
And I was just like, right, I'm doing a bit of modeling, which came out of the blue. Started doing dancing. I started doing all like a bit of fundraising, a bit of just general awareness and stuff like this. And then a guy in the UK messaged me and was like, I was in my hospital bed in recovery, went on Instagram, and then I stumbled across your account and was like, wow, look at this guy. He's further down the road than obviously what I am right now, and how amazing these things that he was kind of like turning his hand to. So that was really nice to hear that. I was kind of like,
that's got to feel very good. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, I'd always said it would be amazing if my story could actually save a life.
Right.
That'd be like, that's the dream.
Right.
But of course, unintentionally, and it's not a word that I would ever say about myself, but people are like, oh, you're so inspirational. I'm like, I'm just doing what I'm doing. It's not, but unintentionally I'm helping people, which is really, really good, even if it's just a, you know, the small group of men that obviously get the diagnosis. So yeah, it's just it's a funny old thing. I mean, how do you feel generally about cancer? Are you, do you, I guess because it's so early days for you, do you have a perception that it's a good thing, it's a bad thing, or are you indifferent, or is that a stupid question? I don't know.
No, it's not. It's not a stupid question. I think I understand what you're getting at. I think it is still new enough that it hasn't, even after the surgery, even after the recovery, after you know, starting tamoxifen and the endless doctor visits for weeks, I still feel as though it hasn't fully sunk in. And maybe that's a good thing, because I don't think I'd want to. I think, similar to what you're talking about, if I can help someone, that's wonderful. But I also don't want to be defined necessarily by it either. So I don't know if at some point it will sort of sink in. You know, maybe after you know, several years in, and maybe after, you know, if the reconstruction happens, you know, I don't know any sort of timing on that, but if that happens, maybe then I'll start to feel differently about it. But it is interesting to feel as though you are part of sort of a bigger network. You are on the fringe of it, right? So for instance, the American Cancer Society every October does a charity walk for breast cancer, and called Making Strides Against Breast Cancer. I'm not sure if they're, you know, maybe there are international versions of it, but here it's run through the American Cancer Society. And I decided to, you know, create a little team. My family and I are going to walk it. And, but it is interesting, right? Because it's, you know, this very pink walk. It's, you know, it's all about, you know, sort of the empowerment of cancer, of breast cancer survivors. So, you know, I feel like I'm very much on the fringe of that. Right.
Yeah.
And,
so when's that, you know, when's that happening?
A week from Sunday.
Oh, right. Okay. So are you
17th? I think.
Yeah. Are people sponsoring you, or is that?
So we just decided. So my oldest daughter just started university this year, and we were trying to coordinate to see, because they do it in multiple locations. We were trying to coordinate which location made the most sense so that she could be a part of it, because I wanted her to be a part of it, and she did too.
Yeah.
And although with maybe a little convincing. But so yes, I will be raising money for it, or, you know, as a team, we will be raising money for it. So
yeah, when I post the video, I'll share the link. So if people
want to, that would be great. Yes. Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah. I think what's going to be interesting is if you have a conversation with anyone, they're going to go, oh, right, who are you supporting? You know, are you, people are going to assume it's probably your wife, I imagine, which is the funny thing. I don't know whether I kind of enjoyed being there.
Yeah.
The unexpected anomaly kind of in the mix.
Right. You've been involved with a lot of fundraising efforts as well.
I mean, not a great deal. I'm trying to find my next challenge. There was a few kind of like hiking expeditions locally in kind of Northern England that happened recently, which I was I nearly went for, and I was thinking it didn't give me a lot of time to kind of raise that much money, so I thought I need a bit of a time period. But yeah, I'm trying to find something a little bit different, a little bit quirky, something that I can maybe, you know, post on my stories and keep people up to date of training or something. I don't know what it'll be, but I'll find something.
Yeah.
So yeah, do you want to talk about English music?
Sure.
Do you know where I live, don't you? Or do you?
No, but if you said you live not far from where OMD were from,
yeah,
they are. I'm trying to think. OMD are from Leeds.
No. Other side of the UK. So it's Merseyside. So it's near Liverpool.
Oh yeah, yes.
Yeah. So I can, if I look out my window, I can see Liverpool.
You can. Okay. Wonderful. Yes. I knew that. Yeah.
So I live literally, I can be at the famous phone box.
Yes.
Are you aware of this phone box? I don't even think I've ever gone to find it, but I know it's there. It's where the band members used to meet up.
Oh, no, I didn't know that. No.
And they actually, because obviously in the UK, red phone boxes all got ripped up years ago, and they got a blue plaque put on this one, and it's still there in Hoylake.
Wow.
Hoylake, and just coincidentally, Hoylake is where Daniel Craig grew up. Yes. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So there you go.
you're not impressed, are you?
No, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Yeah, no, I mean, what a small world. Yeah.
And I have a little bit of a obsession with film locations.
Oh, you do?
An unhealthy obsession. And they, during lockdown, they filmed a lot of the scenes for the new Batman movie in Liverpool.
Oh, wow.
So, because it looks very Gotham City-esque.
Yeah.
It's like a little miniature New York.
Yes. Oh, wow.
So obviously, okay. if you, whenever anyone emigrated from Ireland or from the UK to America, it was generally from Liverpool. So it looks, I think in its day, it was, people used to leave Liverpool and then go to New York, and then New York, kind of like a lot of the buildings and parks and stuff like that are all
very similar.
They're all based on places around here.
Ah, sure.
So
yes.
So during lockdown, I used to go to Birkenhead Park, which is a big park on the Wirral where I live, and that's what Central Park in New York was originally based upon. Yeah.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. Oh, I could bore you with my endless list
of
facts.
Oh, I love it. Yeah.
But yeah, I created a film tour of Liverpool because there was like so many big movies have been filmed there.
Wow, that's great.
But obviously, I think it's cheaper to film outside of London.
Yeah.
So that's why a lot of film companies now are kind of like looking at Liverpool.
Sure.
Let me think of... Actually, there's a movie you might really like called... Away Days, I'm sure. It's Away Days, and it's I think it's got quite a lot of 80s music in it.
Okay.
And that whole film was filmed like literally, one of the scenes was like 50 yards away, and then all along the seafront here is all you can see it in the movie. I think I'm pretty certain it's got a good soundtrack.
Right.
It's about, I think it's like football hooligans and stuff like that, but it's actually not a bad movie.
I will take a look for it.
Do you want to, we should chat again, and I'll obviously check in and see how you're getting on. But I'm so pleased that, I think the big thing there was you saying, you know, you connecting with that guy, Matt.
Yes.
I think is going to really, really help you over the next like 5 years. If not longer.
I think so. I think so. Yeah.
But you're going to help each other, so, you know.
Right.
Yeah, that's
right.
Amazing.
No, it's also interesting, too, because unlike other cancers, or, you know, if you know, we were women, I mean, I think that there's such a small network of men who have gone through this, relatively speaking. I mean, there's still thousands of us, but relatively speaking, there's such a small number of us that I think we're willing to connect with one another and maybe share our stories
Yeah.
a little more than maybe other people who just want to get on with things or focus on their own recovery.
Yeah, but I mean, I get the impression a lot of men want to do exactly that. They want to just right, sit, I'm out of surgery, I'm recovering, I feel okay, right? I'm just going to kind of like it was something that happened to me and that's it.
I
And
know, I know.
I'm sure at some point that's what I'll do, but I was like, I see it as a bit of an opportunity to kind of
Sure.
maybe give back, help,
Sure.
for as long as it is helpful for other people, I guess. Because the other thing is, obviously, I was 44 when I was diagnosed. At some point,
Yeah.
I won't be the youngish bloke. I'll be the oldish bloke, and there'll be another young bloke. So, I think it's quite time sensitive. So I've thought I'll just kind of go for it and see where it leads me. And
Yeah.
so far, I've enjoyed it. I think people have enjoyed watching my journey, and I think
Absolutely. Yeah.
it's kind of beneficial for.
No, I think it's certainly for me, it was great to see somebody who, I mean, 5 years is still relatively fresh, but you're also, young, to see somebody who is that many steps ahead, but also, doing very well. I think it's been encouraging for me to know that, although the tamoxifen is a little bit of a long-term sentence, right?
Yeah.
That there's a that it's manageable, and there's a light at the end of the tunnel too, to see somebody who's gone through all that,
And that shares awesome memes.
yes. Yes, you do. Your meme game is strong, I have to
Thank
say.
you. I appreciate that. Without cancer, I wouldn't be a meme sharer, I guess.
Right.
Oh, look, it was amazing to chat, Sean,
Thank you
and
so much.
we will speak again, no doubt.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I really appreciate this, and thank you for your patience scheduling yesterday. I didn't want you waiting.
Yeah, no worries, no worries. We'll chat again.
Okay, thank
All
you.
right, Sean. See you
All right.
soon. Bye now. Bye.
Bye.